We are in our second of our series, and again, I don't know how many sermons this is, entitled Family Frenzy. Now, this is not a marriage series. This is a family series. There's much more to family than husband and wife. As a matter of fact, singles, we'll deal with that. Your family. Church is family, so there's multiple aspects of family that we will deal with throughout this series. But as we talk today, I want us to start out on a level playing field. Start out in a spot where we can kind of all identify with each other and be in agreement. So here's what I want to do. I want to take a page from AA. Okay? Yeah. You're going, huh? Here it is. Hi, I'm Glenn. I am in a dysfunctional family, and I am from a dysfunctional family. Okay? So there it is. But so are you. Okay? I've been looking at that, and you think, oh no, my family's not dysfunctional. Listen, I spent quite a bit of time going through Scripture and looking at families in the Bible. What I find is a Bible filled with dysfunctional families. From the Garden of Eden, the first family, Adam and Eve, everything was cool. They were not dysfunctional. And then there was that temptation. And then there was that sin. And when God came back through to talk to Adam and Eve, what happened? Adam said, "That woman you gave me." He immediately started blaming Eve, and then the blame game started. The blame game hasn't stopped since then. And their kids? Man, those are stories of their own. But it didn't stop with Adam and Eve. As we look through the Old Testament, we find David, a family of dysfunction. I mean, they were looking for a king, and poor David was left out in the field, and they didn't even consider him. And when his brothers were fighting, you know the story of David and Goliath, and David becomes an errand boy bringing groceries to them, and they made fun of him there. A dysfunctional family. Joseph, his brothers sold him into slavery, one stop short of killing him, which they had really contemplated. A dysfunctional family. Job's family? You say, well, wait a minute, Job was this righteous man. Yeah, but do you remember the advice his wife gave him? Now, I'm not saying that she wasn't hurting, and I'm not saying there wasn't a legitimate struggle there, but that wasn't really the advice he needed to get from someone he loved when he's dealing with the struggles he's dealing with. We can move to the New Testament, and we find Timothy's family. You say, well, his mom and his grandmother were great, but his father was an unbeliever. And you don't see him involved in the raising of Timothy. It's always pointing to his mother and his grandmother. What about Jesus' family, his earthly family? Do you know we find dysfunction there? His brothers and sisters were non-believers all the way through. It seems like they didn't really come to faith in Christ, didn't come to believing faith until after his death and his resurrection. There were times that his family, including his mother, was saying, shh, man, just pull away. Don't do anything. Divert your attention from what you're doing here because it's going to cause problem. And there was all this struggle inside his own earthly family. So when we say that we are from dysfunctional families, if I look at Scripture, we're in the majority. So let's just do something for a second. There's a blank on the phrase that's going to be on the screen in a moment. I want you to join me and join all these families in the Bible and join together, and you fill your name in the blank, okay? So where I said, hi, I'm Glenn, you say, hi, I am, and put your name there, and then we'll finish that. All right, you ready? Hi, I'm Glenn. Wait a minute, are y'all doing that? Did you hear anything, Jerry? I didn't think so. All right, he's hard of hearing. Did you hear anything? You didn't hear much either, right? No. All right, let's do it together. Hi, I'm Glenn. I am part of a dysfunctional family, and I am from a dysfunctional family. Hey, you're doing good. You got it. You say, did I just really admit that out loud? Yeah, we did. And that's okay, because until we recognize where we are, we're not going to get help. Okay, so that just tells us, and we're just saying we're all in some way or another part of a dysfunctional family. So it's out. Now you can listen. My guess is that we all had dreams. My guess is that we all had dreams of those white picket fence kind of homes and families. That yours might have been the place out in the country with a log cabin. The picture could be different, but you know what I mean when I talk about white picket fence homes. Lives. White picket fence families. And for most of us, there are some wonderful things behind our picket fences. There's some things that we look back on and we look at now and we go, wow, I mean, this is good stuff. But for all of us, behind that white picket fence, there's some hurts, there's some tragedies, there's some serious secrets. We all have those because we live in a fallen world. Like some of you, some of you have heard some preachers say, well, when it comes to marriage and when it comes to family, the Bible is the only manual you need. Guys, the Bible is filled with truth. It is truth. It is filled with some great words of encouragement, some warnings, some commands, some wonderful principles. We ought to know them. We ought to live by them. But let me tell you what the Bible is not. The Bible is not a manual for anything. The Bible is a love story of Jesus Christ, God's love for His people and redemption so that we can become His people. But it is not a manual. So if you're looking through here and trying to figure out how to get out of hot water because you forgot Valentine's Day, about the closest thing you're going to find here is just confess it and ask forgiveness and pay the price. We don't need a manual. We need a person. And that person is a person of Christ, Jesus. And Jesus speaks to family issues, but He doesn't do it from the leather overstuffed chair sitting over next to the fireplace where you can sit and listen to the stories. You know what I'm talking about. You've been around those situations where you can just gather and enjoy some hot chocolate or some coffee and hear the stories and just that wonderful time. That's not where Jesus tells us how to deal with family. Jesus deals with family and speaks to family from the place of the skull. Calvary, Golgotha. That's where we find Jesus dealing with family. And we don't often think of it that way, but that is the place. I want you to think about the tension of life. I mentioned it last week. It's bitter and sweet. Think about these tensions. Deep sorrow and overwhelming joy. Life and death, both ends of the spectrum. Everything held at attention. And yes, the tension is found in our families behind the white picket fences, but this tension is no place found any greater than at the cross. The cross, that place of horror and terror, but the cross, that place of salvation, that place of ultimate joy and freedom from death. Of all levels of tension we can find, we find it most at the cross, and it is there that Jesus deals with our issues that we struggle with in family. You remember that day that we read of in Scripture as Jesus is hanging on the cross, and he has those words that you know from by heart when he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, while we're thinking about dysfunctional families, and you hear those words, was this Jesus' plea to a father that was treating him wrongly, a father that was disappointing him? Was he venting his complaint of being rejected by his own father? Was this the time of this ultimate scene of dysfunction that he was crying out? And the answer is no. When it comes to God and Christ, there is no dysfunction. It is that perfect relationship. But so what was Jesus doing here? Do you know he was actually quoting the lyrics of a song? In Psalm 22, we find a song that David wrote. We looked at it when we did our Summer in the Psalms. But today I want you to think of this. As we read this chapter, I want you to think of the tension in family, the tension at the cross, the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. I want you to think of this in the setting of family as we read it. Listen to the song that David wrote and that Jesus on the cross gave us the first words to it again. He says, my God, why have you abandoned me? Why are you so far from my deliverance and from my words of groaning? My God, I cry by day, but you don't answer. By night, yet I have no rest. But you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in you, and they trusted, and you rescued them. They cried to you and were set free. They trusted in you and were not disgraced. But I am a worm, not a man, scorned by mankind and despised by people. Everyone who sees me mocks me. They sneer and they shake their heads. He relies on the Lord. Let him save him. Let the Lord rescue him, since he takes pleasure in him. It was you who brought me out of the womb, making me secure at my mother's breast. I was given over to you at birth. You are my God from my mother's womb. Don't be far away from me, because distress is near, and there's no one to help. Many bulls surround me. Strong ones of Bashan encircle me. They open their mouths against me, lions mauling and roaring. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are disjointed. My heart is like wax melting within me. My strength is dried up like baked clay. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You put me into the dust of death. For dogs have surrounded me. A gang of evildoers has closed in on me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count my bones. People look and stare at me. They divided my garments among themselves, and they cast lots for my clothing. But you, Lord, don't be far away. My strength, come quickly to help me. Rescue my life from the sword, my only life from the power of these dogs. Save me from the lion's mouth, from the horns of the wild oxen. You answered me. I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. I will praise you in the assembly. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. All you descendants of Israel, revere him. For he has not despised or abhorred the torment of the oppressed. He did not hide his face from him, but listened when he cried to him for help. I will give you praise in the great assembly because of you. I will fulfill my vows before those who fear you. The humble will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations will bow down before you, for kinship belongs to the Lord. He rules the nations. All who prosper on earth will eat and bow down. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him, even the one who cannot preserve his life. Their descendants will serve him. The next generation will be told about the Lord. They will come and declare his righteousness to a people yet to be born. They will declare what he has done. What an amazing passage of tension. You see, the psalmist, as he writes, and you think of Christ on the cross, and you see that movement from the terrible to the wonderful, from death to life. You see it all in that text. And what a thing to read, what a truth to read, what a song he has written for us. And we can take that song and apply it to our family. Speaking of family, we think about Mary at the foot of the cross. Can you imagine what seemed to be that looped podcast going? You know, the one that you can't turn off, the one that just keeps playing over and over and over again and gets louder and louder and louder to the point that it hurts your ears. What was on that loop? What was playing as she was at the foot of the cross of her son? You think it might have been words that she had heard almost 33 years earlier, when Jesus was only 8 days old, being held in the hands of the prophet Simeon. In Luke chapter 2, verses 23 and 24, we see that. It says, then Simeon blessed them and told his mother Mary, indeed, this child is destined to cause the fall and the rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, and a sword will pierce your soul, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. On that day that she heard those beautiful words coming from Simeon, she had no idea that it would be a Roman cross that would be piercing her heart. Can you imagine as a parent seeing a child in that situation? You say, well, he was 33 years old. He's still your child. Can you imagine the hurt? Yet she knew that the story and the prophecy by Simeon, there would be good that would come from it, but in the process, she has to go through this struggle. So Mary was essentially collateral damage at the crucifixion. But you know, she's not the only collateral damage at the crucifixion. We're all part of that. You say, well, what do you mean, Pastor? I mean, Jesus said that we must all carry our own cross. We all have cross to bear. And let's just quit making light of that. I hear people say, well, I had to do this. I had to, I don't know, pick some menial task, and that's my cross to bear. It's a whole lot bigger than that. It's a whole lot more than that. Jesus says, each one has a cross to bear. He said things like, only by losing your lives will you find them. He assured us there will be times that we would also be broken and hurt. And when I think of families, many families would secretly say, yep, we're broken. We're struggling. What's behind our white picket fence is not all that pretty. There's some real ugly things back there. And the truth is, many would admit, you know, although we say it's a secret, it's probably not a secret. People see. People know there's, they might not know the details, but they know there's something. But there's the other end of the spectrum. And just as frightening. Maybe you're one of those families that all the other families envy. You know what I'm talking about? Everyone looks at you and looks at your family and goes, man, I wish I had a family like that. I wish my family, I wish my husband, I wish my wife, I wish my kids were like that. That family has it together. Now, I don't know how that feels, but I have known those people in that situation, those families that everyone else looked to. And let me tell you, a pedestal is a terrible place to be. You see, because those families live in fear also. They live in fear of falling off the pedestal. They live in fear of doing something or something happening that's out of their control, and then suddenly people will realize they're not that perfect family. Now, the truth is, all families are dysfunctional, even those that are up on that pedestal. They live in fear of falling off that proverbial pedestal. Or maybe you're one of those families that's just real good at hiding things. It's gone on so long, maybe it's just a way of life. You can keep that inside, and yet you're exhausted. You say, exhausted from what? Exhausted from keeping up a false appearance. You see, we have to make those adjustments when we come out from behind those picket fences, and we have to get out in the real world, so we have to lift up this facade and play these roles. And we always have to remember what the right answer is and what the wrong answer is. And those places, those topics that we go to are those topics that are taboo that we don't ever talk about. It's exhausting. Listen, family is hard no matter where you are in that spectrum. It's just the way it is. Things change. There's risk. There's vulnerability. There are things that you have no control over. And sooner or later, the ruggedness of the cross begins to rub on your bare skin. And all it has to do is break the skin a little bit, and then that thing gets real heavy and real hurtful. Constantly rubbing, rubbing, rubbing. And it's here that we find that we can't do it alone. We can't deal with it alone. Remember when Jesus was hanging on the cross and he turned his eyes to John and then to his mother, and he strained through the pain to provide care for his mother at the hands of his most beloved disciple. There's care that's needed. There's help that's needed. And Jesus even recognized that through his pain and his anguish on the cross. Can you imagine being nailed to the cross and being concerned for someone that's not on the cross? But that's what Jesus demonstrates to us. And it's with this that I want to challenge us a little bit. There will be an entire sermon on it later. But it's here where Jesus turns to the disciple and he says, care for my mother. That I think there's some words for the church there. There's a point for the church. It may be highlighting one of the most, maybe the greatest failure, one of the greatest failures of the 21st century church. You see, today, each family unit arrives week after week. They might split up as they get here, and you go to your class, and I go to my class, and we're all over this church property, and then we come back together, and we worship for a little while together in music, and then our kids run off to another area, and so we're here together. We do the church things for an hour, maybe two, and then we retreat back into our individual automobiles. We shut ourselves off from the rest of the world and from the church for another week. I think what we're seeing is that the church has lost the distinction of what it means to be church family, brothers and sisters in Christ. That responsibility, that love, that concern. See, Jesus had other half-brothers and sisters, but he looked to a disciple, not a blood brother, a disciple, and he said, "Would you care for my mom?" I think we can rightly conclude that until we are disciples, we cannot be the families that we should be. We can do it. I mean, the world's filled with people doing family. But until you and I as believers get to that place where we're growing in our understanding of Christ and we're growing in our walk with Christ and we're truly disciples, then we can't be the family that God wants us to be. We need to recognize and embrace the joy and the responsibility that comes from being part of family, not based on biological blood, but based on crucifixion blood. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. That means His blood brings us to kin. It's His blood that makes us brothers and sisters. And I'm going to tell you that I have seen when this is working well, those that are kin by crucifixion blood will stick together and will care for each other when those that are kin by biological blood will turn their backs. The cross holds us together. I don't know of a pastor who can't tell one or more stories of concluding church prayer meeting only to have some dear woman come by and whisper something like this, "Pastor, would you pray for my family? Our son's gone off to college and he's decided now that he's an atheist." The pastor says, "Well, of course I will." But then he'll venture into that strange world of asking another question. And he'll ask a question like, "Why didn't you share that? We just left prayer meeting. Why didn't you share that with your church family?" And the answer always comes back, and it can be changed with words depending on the situation, but it always sounds something like this: "People will wonder what we've done wrong, where we messed up, where we weren't the parents that we should have been. People will wonder how on earth we could have ended up with a kid that made a decision like this. And Pastor, it would embarrass my husband." You know, I think that says more about the church than it does about that individual needing prayer. Shame on the church when we are not, or at least given the appearances of being trustworthy when it comes to real life hurts of families. When we are not good stewards of information that we receive when people in the family's hurting. Too often, people have given that information out. They've been vulnerable enough to say, "Here's what's really happening behind my picket fence," only to have church members gossip. Only to have church members look down on them. Only to have church members condemn them. That's not healthy family. That's not healthy family joined together in the blood of Christ. We need to be brothers and sisters who love each other and who care for each other. Now, there will be a whole sermon on that later. But I just remind us again, family's not easy. If it were, you could do it on your own. We cannot bear the cross with our own willpower. We must let our pride and our self-sufficiency be crushed so that we will be willing to be led. Christ wants to lead us. He wants to help us, but until we say, "Lord, humbly, I need you. I can't do it on my own." And most of us are going to say, I've tried. I've got the scars to show it. Lord, I've tried to do it on my own and I can't. I'm turning to you. But I want you to think about something else that we see at the cross of Christ. The Bible tells us that not one of his bones were broken. Why? You know, the answer I always get, I spent some time in commentaries trying to chase down the answer to this. Do you know what it says? Everybody I've heard, everybody I read said, well, it's so that prophecy would be fulfilled. Okay, cool. But what does that mean for us? There's got to be more to that point than prophecy is fulfilled. Dr. Russell Moore points out that this one thing demonstrates that when it looks like there's not an end to your struggle, when it looks like it's going to get worse and worse and worse and there is no end, God has still put limits on your circumstances. Think about what happened on the cross. God said, not any further. You're not going to break a bone. Have you ever felt like everything was crashing in and there was no hope? Listen, you need to remember that God has put limits on Satan. He said, he did it with Job. He said, you can't go any further. You can't kill him. So he's put limits on all of our lives. And he said, yes, Satan, part of living in a fallen world or these things are going to come down upon you, but there is a limit to what I will allow to take place. We can trust God with his limits. We can trust his sovereignty that he's still in control, even when it hurts. He has not given Satan unlimited access and unlimited power over you and your life. So here's what I want you to remember. Sing the whole song. Sing the whole song. Think about the fact that when Jesus was on the cross, those first words, my God, why have you forsaken me? But when he said that, he knew all the rest of the verses. He knew the entire song. He knew there was the terrible things. He knew there was the agony. He knew there was the hurt. He knew there was the pain and the suffering, but he also knew the other end, that his Father was still in control. And that great good was going to come from what was taking place. And that through him we would all have access to eternal life. Sing the whole song. Don't just get stuck in the pain and the suffering, but know there's joy and healing and life. I don't know about you, but I've never thought that much about the cross being that way. When we take our family to the cross, we get to see the whole picture. Maybe not all the details of how it's going to work out, but we get to see the whole picture because the cross ends in life, in resurrection. It's what I love about the song that we had today during the offertory. Scars. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but you got them? We all do. I've got that one right there. One of the neatest days in my young life was to get a knife. A three-blade knife. Razor sharp. Watched my grandfather sit there and sharpen it. And when it was given to me, he said, now be careful. Well, I mean, dude, I'd had some little kid knives before. I'd had a real knife before, but it wouldn't get sharp. But this one had three blades. So I opened one, and I opened the other, and then I went back to get that third blade that opens the same way the big blade, and I stuck my thumbnail in there, and I pulled that thing up. You know what happened. My thumb slipped, and right there, that knife cut my finger. I've still got a scar. I don't ever open blades like that anymore. When our grandkids, and when they're talking about knives, I'm going, look, don't do that. A scar reminds me. I've got one across this knee right here. some of you can't identify with this, but when we were kids and growing up in Houston, we had sidewalks from one end of the neighborhood to the other, and we like to do things fast. There's four boys in our family. So we tied a rope to the bicycle, and I got us on a set of steel wheel, metal wheel roller skates. And my brother got on the bike, and off we go. I used to think that was a long block. Now that I'm an adult, I drove back by there one time. It's an awful short block, but man, it seemed like forever I was behind that. And we'd get to a bump in the sidewalk, and I got good enough I could jump the bumps and stay on my feet, and here he's still pedaling. He got to that pickup that was parked across the sidewalk, that neighbor that really didn't like anyway. I think he set it there right for me. That bicycle made a hard left. Have you ever tried to make a hard left on the end of a rope? Doesn't work. Got it right across the knee, laid that knee open. Taught me to stay off the end, the wrong end of a rope. But that scar reminds me of things. Did you hear the words of that song? Wake up to a new sunrise. Looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain. I wouldn't trade it for anything because my brokenness brought me to you. And these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars because without them, I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever, I'm thankful for the scars. Now I'm sending in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. I am not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. I'm so thankful for the scars, because without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell who you are, so I'm thankful. I'm forever thankful for the scars. I can see. How you delivered me, your hands, your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I am thankful for your scars, because without them, I wouldn't know your heart. And with my life, I'll tell who you are. So forever, I'm thankful. I'm thankful for the scars. See, behind our picket fences, there are families struggling and family joys. Behind the picket fences, there are scars. But what amazed me about this song is, without me realizing it the first time I heard it, I had to go back and listen to it again. And what the writers of this song do so well is at the beginning, I'm hearing it and I'm thinking about my scars. And I've got scars. But in the middle of the song, they literally change. And they're not talking about my scars anymore. They're talking about God's scars, Christ's scars. And what I realized as I listened to that thing several times is that my scars, when I get to the cross, are hidden behind His scars. Only at the cross does that happen. Only in Christ does that happen. And what we realize then is that the cross is where our scars don't define us. How many of us live with scars of family, scars of life, that has become in our lives what defines who we are? But when you bring it to the cross, those scars no longer define you. What defines you are the scars of Christ. Your scars are hidden in Him. So I don't have to live that life anymore with those scars. Yeah, they're still there and they're reminders to me, and they will always be, because God's given us the inability to forget. All that stuff, those neat cliches, forgive and forget, God's given us the ability not to forget to help protect us, but I don't have to be defined by that part of my life. At the cross, He hides my scars. At the cross, He gets the honor and the glory, and I see purpose even for my scars. At the cross, it becomes your scars, not my scars. What a beautiful picture. What an assurance. So, hey, family, there behind the picket fence, walk out and come to the cross. Leave that facade of safety that picket fence puts up and come to the cross where you can find not relief, but healing. Perfect healing in Christ. I wish we didn't have to have scars, but that's part of living in a fallen world. But I'm so thankful we have the cross. We have a Savior. We have Jesus Christ that we can go to, and He understands. In no place in life will we find a more beautiful picture of how to deal with the tensions of life, the tensions of family, than at the cross. It is there that we find deliverance. It's there that we find victory. It's there that we can be thankful, and only there that we can be thankful for the scars. Because, Lord, without them, I wouldn't know Your heart.